The floor is mine. I feel like I'm in the pulpit. Holler. Good evening. I don't know why I'm screaming, except that I don't typically do these at the bottom looking up, so it's kind of disorienting, so just allow me to get my sea legs. My name is Ethan Chazen. I am a career coach and a business consultant, and I can proudly say that over 25 years in corporate America, I was laid off, downsized, right-sized, re-engineered, offshored, riffed. Any of you guys hear of RIFT? Reduction in force. 9 times. Never once for performance. The last time I was laid off was in 2008. I was on the management team of a company you may have heard of, Time Warner Cable. And I said, that's it. I'm done. I'm not ever going to work another day for anybody else. I woke up my wife in the middle of the night, October 17th, 2008. I said, honey. We went to high school together, so I knew she was narcoleptic, so if I woke her up, she'd go back to bed. I said, honey, I know what I want to do for the rest of my life. She said, what? I said, I want to help as many people as I can find their dream job. She literally, since she's known me 20-some-odd years, said, it took you long enough, and went back to bed. I had my wife attorney's approval. I rushed forward. I wrote a book that week called Bulletproof Your Career in Turbulent Times. Pay attention, there is no way to bulletproof your career in turbulent times. We are in the 21st century contract economy. So, I took the message about branding yourself, I went out, and I've given this talk and other talks to over 50 colleges and universities. I'm an adjunct professor at NYU, Fordham, Columbia, Baruch, Hunter, et cetera, et cetera. The reason I'm here tonight is to share with you what Dr. Hempel was saying just a few minutes ago. Online branding is just one piece of how you promote yourself. It supports all your offline branding. And your offline branding can be summed up in one word: networking. Get your butt out to events. I'm here tonight because I'm an alum of Wagner College, who's the Dean of Student Life at the college in my town, Hoboken, called Stevens Institute of Technology, who made an introduction on my behalf with Dr. Hempel. We spoke to each other. I came in end of February and talked about the first part of this program. If you can be at that event, get there. If the alumni who are going to be at the event aren't old fart middle-aged 40-something-year-olds, but if they've been in the private sector, they graduated from here like 5 or 6 years ago, they are, with all due respect to your parents, your friends, your family, your professors, your advisors, your spiritual advisors, they're the most important people for you to get a chance to meet. Why? Because they know what you're going through. They graduated from here, and we went into a depression in 2008. We're still not out of. So if they graduated from Wagner around that time, they got a job, you want to talk to them about how the heck they did it. When Dr. Hempel circulates the list of who they are, what their names are, where they work, my expectation of you, do the research. Find out all you can about them. And when you go to this alumni networking event, you want to introduce yourself proudly, leverage your brand that you're going to build online, and have a conversation with them about their challenges, what they went through when they graduated. So this is going to be a weird kind of logistical setup. I have to turn my back to you periodically to turn the slide. Is everybody here cool with that? Because if you say no, it doesn't really matter. I got to turn around. But I want to do something because 100% of the time I get the answer I'm looking for. Who here has a Facebook account? Oh, come on, put your hands up in the air. I'm doing all the work. Okay, about 60, 65%. Who here has a LinkedIn account? Good, I expected to see fewer hands. So my expectation by Friday close of business, 5 p.m., 100% of you will have raised your hand to both of those questions. Because if you think about this, Facebook gives you access to 1 billion people. 1 billion, and it's free. And by the way, your potential employers, if they go to Facebook and don't find you there, they're going to wonder why not. LinkedIn. LinkedIn is a networking tool free for 200 million people. And they are all job placement professionals, recruiters, staffing agencies, employers, people in human resources. You need to build your brand. So when I talk about a brand, I talk about something very specific. If you think about your career at Wagner and high school, in junior high school, from when you're going to graduate here, working backwards, your brand may be as you think it might be, your major, your field of study, your minor, the classes you took. That's like this big a piece of who you are. It's the values that you got growing up in your family, your beliefs, your interests, your passions, your hobbies, the stuff you've done that you never got paid for, volunteer work, summer work. All that stuff is your brand. And so you have to be true to what your brand is when you're online and when you're offline, meeting people in the real world. That's what tonight is all about, making sure that who you are as a brand is represented in the best possible light for people to find you, not only online, but when they check you out online, and then they meet you at an alumni event or a networking event, and they go back and then check you out again or see you for the first time online. There's no difference between your online and your offline brand. So, having said that, how many people here are senior? Juniors? All right, I'm getting a sense. That's great, because that's what I kind of thought it was. That's what Dr. Hempel said it would be. You have limited time to finish up building this brand before you graduate. How do you become an expert in your field between now and when you graduate? And going into after you graduate, as you enter into the private sector or corporate America, or if you go into nonprofits, that's fine, or government work, what are the classes you've taken? Have you written any articles? Have you been published? Do you have a blog? Have you done any research papers? Have you done group projects? If you were to go on an interview and I said to you, tell me why I should hire you, you need to be able to answer that. That's the cold, hard facts of the economy that we're in. And the way that you answer that is to point to how you've become a subject matter expert on your chosen major. I have 8 nieces and nephews who are high school senior, getting ready to go to either Penn or Stanford, all the way up to my oldest is 25, graduated from Brown. I talk to them about this all the time. I'm the only one in our family, my wife and my family, who has access to all their social media accounts. I'm constantly telling them, what's your major? Economics, what's your major? Chemical engineering, what's your major? Communications, I don't care what it is. How much do you know about the industry that you're going to be going into? And how do you talk about yourself as an expert? This is going to be a tough one because I thought I'd have it in front of me. So I'm going to do this to this. LinkedIn is free. It is, if you think about it, it's a resume, an online resume service on acid or on speed. You create a resume, yeah, that's what you're going to do when you go into LinkedIn and you create your account. But you're also going to have access. I want to be real clear about this. The beauty of LinkedIn is you can search those 200 million people where they went to college. Search Wagner College, and it'll come up in all the results. You can search by company. You can search by industry for those 200 million people. The thing about any of these social media sites is it's a two-way relationship. So just like you can search for people who maybe went to Wagner, people, if they're searching and you're there, they'll find you, which is great, except you need to make sure your brand is nailed down. So one of the things that you can do with LinkedIn, it has a tab at the top, and I'm not going to fly through, you know, to try and do it online to show you, but there's something called groups in LinkedIn. You can join up to, I think the limit is 52 groups of people who share your background, your field of study, whether it's econ or finance or communications, advertising, whatever your field of study is, you can search up to 50 some odd groups and join the groups. And once you join the groups, it's like being a fly on the wall in a room where all these professionals get together and looking at what they're talking about, monitoring the things that people who are already working in your field of study are talking to each other about. Let me say this again. That's how you start to learn the challenges that the people who may have jobs are talking to other people in the industries you're interested in every day. So you go in, you join a group, you create your account, you're basically taking your resume information and putting it into LinkedIn and joining groups. But there's something else going on here. In LinkedIn, once you create an account, you can create links or invite people to connect with you. This is critical. You want to not only have fellow students that you're linked to, but professors, faculty, deans of the department where you're getting your degree from, faculty advisors, people if you're in any clubs who belong to the same club as you. As you start to invite people to connect with you and that universe builds, you want to be real strategic about all the connections you make. So I'll say this to you, the same way if you were getting ready to figure out how to do a job search, which most of you are, there should be in your head a number. The number is 18 to 32. 18 to 32 organizations that you want to target through all these social media. The way the number comes out is 3 to 4 industries, whether it's sports, hip-hop, media, music, whatever, the 3 or 4 software, app development, mobile technology, doesn't matter. Whatever 3 to 4 industries you're interested in, start with 6, 7, or 8 organizations, companies, nonprofit agencies in each of those. So 3 to 4 industries, 6, 7, or 8 organizations in each. You now are going to start to search through LinkedIn and invite people to connect with you. LinkedIn is kind of difficult. What happens is when you want to connect to somebody who's a stranger, it doesn't matter if it's LinkedIn or any other social media tool. It's the same thing as sitting in a room with a complete stranger and trying to go up to them and shake her hand. If you don't know them, you need to send them an invitation which shows you've done research, you know who she is, and you want to introduce yourself for some specific reason. So let's say it's somebody in their late 20s, graduated from Wagner's, working at a broadcasting company or a cable company, and you're interested in that industry. You would send a LinkedIn invitation, which when you send a LinkedIn invitation, it gives you a generic invitation. I'd like to connect with you to LinkedIn. That's crap. Just delete that. Get rid of it. And say, dear Jane or dear Joe, I'm getting ready to graduate from Wagner. I see you're at Comcast. I'm interested in cable. Would like to invite you to connect with me. That's how you send out a personalized introduction, which if you were meeting her in person and you shook hands, it's the same introduction. Think about that as you're starting to make relationships with people online and getting your brand out there. You have to have a message and you have to tailor your message when you meet people, whether it's in person or online. LinkedIn's kind of unique, and why I tell every one of my nieces, nephews, my college students, because I teach in a number of colleges, when you're creating a LinkedIn profile, there's something really cool that you can do. The reason you're sending introductions, invitations to your teachers, your faculty advisors, you can ask people to recommend you. In the old days, that would be the sheet called references that you put behind your resume. Most people aren't going to read your resume in paper. They're going to go check out your social media profiles. How many recommendations do you have? How many endorsements? When you create your profile in LinkedIn, this is really an important thing, they're going to ask you what interest or areas of study you want to select from in their list to associate with who you are. If it's advertising, print media, internet marketing, branding, whatever the things are, economics, macro, microeconomics, film production, whatever the top 5, 6, 7, 10 things you're really interested in, indicate that. Because if you have any expertise from classes you took where a professor thought you did really well in her class, or if you had any volunteer work or internships or summer jobs or jobs this semester or the last semesters, you're going to send a request to your professors. And my students, I demand that they do this, asking me for recommendations, assuming they're a good student. I don't really like doing recommendations for students who get D's or F's, but you get the idea behind this. In LinkedIn, you can have people who know you endorse you. And endorsement is, once you indicate the stuff you're strong at, it's literally giving you a LinkedIn electronic thumbs up. Social media, branding, research, data entry, whatever your strengths are. That's an endorsement in LinkedIn. But a recommendation is they write something really nice about you. And the beauty of that is it won't automatically go to your profile. You'll get an email through LinkedIn into your email, and it'll say, hey, you have a recommendation from Professor Chazen. Do you want to approve it? Only after you approve it will it get posted on your LinkedIn site. The trick to this is you don't want anybody to have to write a recommendation for you without you coaching them what to say. This may sound weird. What the heck are you talking about? I'm going to tell somebody what they should say about me? Yeah. In effect, yeah. You want to say, dear Professor Chazen, I created my LinkedIn account. We had the class on direct marketing. I'm looking to get into a job in direct marketing or digital media. I'd love it if you could write a recommendation about the project that I did in your class on, or whatever. That's just making a general suggestion, but that's what you want to do with LinkedIn. So you send invitations to people to join you. This is really hard to see. But when you go to your LinkedIn profile, once you create it, you can see these are some of the recommendations that I have. This is called salesmanship in print. It doesn't matter how great you say you are. What only matters, especially in my line of work, is if I have 10 students who say he did a really good job teaching me, that's great. But if I have 100 students saying he's an awesome professor, I don't need to speak about how effective I am. Same goes with you guys. If you have recommendations in your profiles, things that people have said about you that are really positive, it speaks for itself. Go back the next few days into next week. Think. Who can you get a recommendation from? Well, at a more basic level, you have to create your account first. And then you have to send invitations to people to connect with you. This is critical. If I'm losing you already, there's no hope. But if I still have you, that's great. Because if you have a conversation with somebody and they think you're pretty strong as far as somebody who potentially could help their organization, they're going to go look for you online. I want you to take away from tonight a pretty important question. Right now, as it stands, what does your brand say about you online? More importantly, do you even have a brand online? If not, cool. It's rhetorical. It's meant to get you thinking along the lines of, I need to scramble to build an online brand because people I know now are looking at me online more often before you even have a chance to talk to them in person. There's a section in LinkedIn which says summary. That's your work history. Work is not just paid jobs. Work is volunteer work. Work is internships. It's summer work. It's maybe you did fundraisers, charity events, mentoring, Big Brother, you know, Toys for Tots, Race for the Cure. Things that you've done, whether paid or not, you take right off the professional experience part of your resume, you put it into LinkedIn. If I read your resume on LinkedIn, if I read your work experience on your resume, it doesn't matter where the information is. The question that you need to ask yourself and really scramble to fix if it's a problem is the following. When you tell me about yourself, do I go, wow, tell me more. Or do I go, I got 99 other Wagner students to see? That's a really powerful, and I realize it may be insulting to some of you to hear me say that. That's what people are thinking right now. You need to think about how your brand, online or offline, and ideally both, how it reinforces this message of what is there about me? And this is the clinic definition of a brand. Unique, invaluable, memorable. If you go to speak at this networking event to fellow Wagner alum, especially younger ones, they know what it means to graduate from Wagner. You've already got them on your side, but they're going to want to know. You went to Wagner? That's great. What do you have to offer that's different than anybody else, not just in the university, but in that school or that department or even in your class? So that's how you start to think about this. I mentioned groups. The really cool thing about LinkedIn, it's really hard for me to kind of show you without kind of tooling around. We don't have time for that. This is a flyby. This is a drone strike. It's a really quick overview, and then you guys will dive into more detail, I hope, once you go into the accounts. But when you start joining groups, the algorithms, the software, this is where the people like Reid Hoffman who built LinkedIn, it's brilliant. You join one, two, three groups, it's going to search the tens of thousands of groups that already exist and start spitting out recommendations for you of other groups. There is no excuse not to be able to do a significant amount of research online to find people in your field of study who are Wagner graduates already in the private sector working that you can start a conversation with by joining groups and getting more familiar with what the challenges are that these professionals face. This is a networking group. You call yourself seniors, juniors, you may belong to clubs, you may be on sports teams. You are a group. Why? I mean, has anybody here, if you're in LinkedIn, with your friends or your peers, said, let's start a LinkedIn Wagner student group? Start to think about people you can connect with. The sooner the better. What you want to have is a Rolodex of accounts, people who you can have conversations with about things that's going on in the business world. You can also literally type in the exact job you're looking for in the job title, the city, job title, the city, the company, or organization, and it'll tell you if there are any jobs. 200 million people are on this. There's no reason not to be, but when you do create your account, the information you use has got to be the same as all the other social media sites you have, but also your resume, because your brand has to tell the story of you the same way everywhere anybody goes to find out about you. One of the first things I'll suggest, once you create a LinkedIn account, there's a tab, a button at the top. It's called search. Just for giggles, go in and start searching stuff like Wagner, Wagner College, or companies you're interested in. 2, 3, 4 companies. For example, LinkedIn as a company. They're at the Empire State Building in Manhattan. Or Google, or Nike, or Zappos, or Tom's Shoes. I mean, and Wagner College. And you'll start to see alum who went to the same school as you who are working in companies who are doing some exciting stuff and are great places to work. I have to tell you, part of me is on the fence about Twitter. Part of me wants to tell you, go out if you don't have a Twitter account. Just leave right now and create a Twitter account. It's that important. And part of me thinks it's glorified stalking, which means it's all about how many people are tweeting and following you. The reason I want to talk about Twitter is it's a great way to see it's called trending. The things that people are tweeting about, putting messages in that are popular. Not about Beyonce, bad example. Rahana and Chris, on again, off again. But the stuff that's trending about the two or three or four industries that you want to work in, let me ask quickly, who here's got a Twitter account? About 65, 70%. So I'm already preaching to the choir. It's the same as any social media tool. In order for you to get your brand out, you need to have connections. People don't know what you're up to, and they're not aware of what you're doing professionally or here at school academically unless they're following you. How do you get people to follow you? Professors, faculty, deans, fellow students, alum who you meet or are going to meet. This is a snapshot of my page. And so what it does is, for those of you who may not be familiar with it, right side, all the way to the top, that's your brand. It allows you to put your name, your Twitter account, the at symbol, the little A in the circle, and your name, or whatever your Twitter account is, which it should be your name, first name, last name. It'll tell you the number of tweets, a tweet's 140 character message, tweet, that you send out, the number of people you're following, and the number of people who follow you. This is not an exact science. Yes, sir? That's the million-dollar question. You guys heard that, right? You want to separate what's personal and what's professional. There's two schools of thought on that one. So the first is, there is no difference. Yeah, same thing. I used to believe that, and now I don't. But if you're just starting out and you have one Facebook account and you're using it for job searching and also your personal life, you either have to really tone down what you're saying about yourself and your personal life, or you have to just do nothing but talk about yourself as if you're looking for a job on your personal site, and then that looks boring, and people who want to have a conversation with you about your personal life, they say, you're boring. So the other side of the fence is, have two separate accounts. First of all, it's free. You can create a personal account where those people who already know you and have a relationship with you, you'll maintain that relationship. But creating a professional account allows you to talk about yourself in an entirely different light. And you'd be surprised, for those of you who use photos, visual imagery of your brand, the kind of things that I've had my nieces and nephews pull down off their sites because I've seen it and I said, you can't be doing stuff like that and have people maybe find you online. That's the challenge. Even if you set your privacy settings a certain way to restrict access of your personal account, people still can find you. So there are two schools of thought. I always am of the belief of, rather than have one account and just do everything about job searching, split it out. That's not a silly question. I had one account on Facebook for my business, where I've coached over 750 organizations from Goldman Sachs to Calvin Klein. I had one account for my business and my personal, and I was constantly talking about my business. I'm going out to Wagner College tonight to talk about social media. People are like, really? Again, you're talking about your business? Kind of a narcissist, aren't you? Yeah, you're all about yourself. So I split it out. Relatively recently, so I have a business account on Facebook, and I have a personal account. Twitter, I have one account. As to why you're doing this in the first place, the whole point of why Dr. Hempel invited me in tonight is for your career branding, your personal exploration, getting ready to job search. So I would say, if you have a personal one and you talk about personal stuff, fine. Just make sure, have somebody you know or trust who's a parent, a faculty advisor, Dr. Hempel, anybody on his team. Have somebody who you trust take a look at your personal accounts to make sure that they're still okay. But I'd say create a professional one also. So you have two separate. Does that kind of get to cool? So one of the things that you'll see about Twitter, it supports, by the way, there's no one social media tool that's right or wrong. There are a few that are going to build your core foundation. So Facebook's the first one. Twitter is the second. In Twitter, Once the general rule is, and there's no science on this, you should have two times as many people that you're following as are following you. So if you have 150 people following you, you should be following 300 people. If you have 250 people following you, you should be following 500. It's not an exact science, but that's just kind of a good benchmark of how many people you're reaching out to. Unless you're like Lindsay Lohan and you have 8 million followers and she's following 20 from the comfort of her prison cell. That one never goes over well. So the way your Twitter account is, your brand is at the top. It's your name, it's your location. I would put your LinkedIn profile and I would put your Facebook profile. But you would also want to put a one phrase, 5 to 8 words, considered a tagline of what your product is. Wagner College graduating senior majoring in communications, let's say. Major communications, minor advertising. So maybe that's what your brand is. So that's at the top, right. Bottom right is your feed. It's all the tweets, the messages, those 140 characters of things you sent out. Twitter, just like your Facebook professional page, you make announcements about classes you're taking, research papers you're writing, projects you're doing in a class you like, an alumni event at Wagner College you're going to in the city. Anything that you want people to start seeing around your brand. One of the things you do is you use what's called the hashtag. It's a number sign. Anytime you send a tweet, do you guys know a hashtag? It's a pound symbol and a one or two word combination, no spaces if they're multiple words, put together. The algorithm gods at Twitter will see every time you send out a tweet where you put a hashtag around a certain term, it'll create an association with however many times you use that hashtag, word or words, with your account. So if you want to say Wagner College, communications major, going to event that, you put the hashtag or the Wagner, or the at symbol for the Wagner College Twitter account. And then communications, hashtag internet or advertising. You're creating an online brand by using tweets that have hashtags as keywords for your product, your brand. The beauty is, as you start to follow people, and people start to follow you, Twitter is going to say, oh, right, I get it. You follow them in this industry. Hey, why not follow them? It does the heavy lifting. It exponentially expands your networking online by constantly making suggestions to you about who to follow, who's following you, who are you following. The beauty is every time you send out a tweet, the people who are following you get the message, so you're building your brand, and as more people start following you, and you do more tweets, more people are hearing what you have to say, and more people are liking it or commenting on it. That's how you build an online brand. In the same way you're not selfish when you go to networking groups and you don't talk about yourself the whole time, you ask Wagner alum at this networking event, what is it like? What was it like finding a job after you graduated from Wagner? What do you do day in and day out? What do you enjoy most about your job? What do you enjoy least about your job? You have an econ major and you went into poli sci or fundraising. How did that happen? The way you're asking questions and sparking conversation in a room when you're meeting with people, you do it online. What that means is don't be selfish online. You're asking questions periodically, but you're also sharing information. If you see an article, a professor tells you there's a great research paper or a great trade association in your field, share it. Share information, ask questions, but also share information. If you have, let's say, somebody who came to Wagner College tonight and gave a talk on social media, and you thought the talk was kind of interesting, and you have a Twitter account, you may go into Twitter and write a tweet that says, heard great talk at Ethan Chazen on social media, awesome starting point for branding. That's how you get known online, and you also create connections. Oh God. You see what happens when you're a freshman and you go on one bad date and you get rejected and you go back to your dorm room and you create an empire worth billions of dollars with 900 million followers? That doesn't happen to everybody. So, sir, here's the question. Oh God, how many chins? So this is Facebook. This is my personal page. Forget about all the me stuff. What happens is you have the wallpaper, the billboard. You can just find imagery that you like. Well, this happens to me in my town of Hoboken. But you want to be so specific in your branding that you may want to use imageries if you're an engineer, or there's a certain kind of engineering, or communications, or branding, or interactive marketing. You can actually find images for free. Just do a Google search and say, you know, image search, whatever the specific image, and post it up as your cover image. But it allows you to put a picture of yourself. Your job title would be interactive marketing or branding major at Wagner College. Studied whatever the subject is at Wagner College. Lives in, you may say, Staten Island or wherever. This is personal. I'm in a little bit different situation than you guys. I have a business, but I also have my not business stuff. This used to be almost all business stuff, so I stripped it out and changed it up a little bit. But what I did with, this is my business page. So for you guys, this is going to be more of what your brand looks like. I just copied that wallpaper image from Google. I did a search. That's my business name. Here's where it's important. Can I do this? This is your universe. This is the people who like you, who understand that you're out there. You have a Facebook, professional Facebook page that you're getting ready to use for your job search and building your brand, who like you. This is important. Who do you know? Family, friends, family of friends of family, professors, instructors, deans, guest lecturers, Wagner alum, people you may have worked for in a prior job. How can you get them to start liking your business page? You start liking them. You start sending them messages. Right now, you should have a script. The script should say, getting ready to graduate soon. Looking forward to launching my career. Something along these lines. You guys, don't go by my specific words. Just get a flavor for this. Starting to make network, starting to go out and network for life after Wagner. Would love to chat with you about your experiences at, let's say they work at Google. If they're a Wagner alum, your experiences after you graduated from Wagner and how you found your current position at LinkedIn or Nike or Mashable or whatever. This is how you create connections online and then the relationships that come out of that. Oh my God. Does anybody here blog? One, two, I got two, I got three, I got one of these. Which is kind of yes, no, so that's what, a 0.5? That's like 3.5, if you round up, it's a 4. Two things. First of all, there are free services that you can, literally, you guys are the tech-savvy ones. I'm the tech idiot. But you could go to Google Blogger and create an account 5 minutes after you leave this class. The more important question is, what do you blog about? my experiences during spring break at, no. But maybe my experiences trying to find work in a jobless economy. My experiences trying to start my brand at Wagner College. What do you have to say to people on an interview or networking? It's the same stuff you're going to say when you're writing a blog. What do you find most interesting that you are passionate about? I talked about this back in February when I was here, but in another building, in another room. It's the same concept. There are two things in life as you get ready to graduate that you should care about more than anything else. First is what you're really technically strong at. That's your field of study. That's your major. That's why you took all those classes. That's this hand. And then this other hand is a hell of a lot more important. It's what your passion is. The way that these two come together, that's what you should be building your brand for. Life is too short to do what I did and spend 25 years wasting my career working in organizations, helping them build powerful brands to make them money to get downsized. So think about, as you're starting to build your brand, the idea that if you blog, a blog is just an article. Every week, every predetermined regular schedule, every week, every 2 weeks, on a certain topic or topics related to what your background, your field of study is, the classes you've taken, your work experience, living on campus, moving off campus, whatever. People are going to hire you if they're emotionally connected to you and they trust your brand, which is you as a graduate. What do you have to offer? The blogging is a really cool way to create a reputation for yourself. The other thing of social media, Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, you can ask questions. Getting ready to go to a networking event with Wagner alum in 2 weeks. Three of the companies are, when Dr. Hempel posts the list of companies. Anybody know how to find information on them? When you use your social media to ask questions, the people who you're connected to, these are the people who you would think know you best and like you most. Use social media as a way to get feedback from people, ideas, information. You're also going to be giving back by sharing, but that's one way to ask questions. Me doing this, I asked somebody in my network if anybody knew somebody at Wagner. That's how I met Dr. Hempel. That's how you start to see how you can make connections, is to start asking people questions. Ow, ow, ow. Does everybody have a Meetup account? What the hell is Meetup? It's free. You may be hearing a lot of that. I may not be speaking necessarily as clearly as I should, but it's free. There's no excuse. Well, what the hell is it? What good does it do whether it's free or not? It is a website that you go to when you want to find people by entering your zip code who are professionals who have and share your background interests, perhaps your where you graduated from, your alma mater. Maybe they work in the industry you work in. You go to meetup.com, create an account profile, put in a zip code and the two or three or four words of the kinds of people you want to meet, and you click search. And you can say the groups within a 5, 10, 25 mile radius. It will give you all of the groups of people who get together. They meet up in person. See, I'm going to go completely off-roading. I'm getting completely off my script right now. You don't have any excuses. Back in the day, I'm an old fart. I'm vertically, circumferentially, and follically challenged. But back in the day, thank you very much, for us to get this stuff, life BI before internet, 1995, we would go to the library and talk to these really old 90-year-old angry women and say, I'm looking for information to find people who work in these companies. And we'd go to the stacks. The stacks was like this. You go into the building, you go down all the way to the basement, dust, vomit, it smelled, dry paint, and you'd have these huge drawers filled with little cards. And the cards, there were thousands, you searched to find the one article in Time magazine from 3 years ago. Now, allow me to replay that scenario with what you go through. Google, Bing, Yahoo, search. You can find all this information. The bottom line is, when you're creating your online brand empire, these are the tools. You now have four. LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, Meetup. So when you go, you create an account, you say what you're looking for, you search for groups. Every time you go and you search, they'll retrieve the groups that you've already asked to be invited to join that have accepted your request. And you'll see, you get emails right to your Gmail account. Hey, you join this group? We're getting together in 2 weeks at this bar or restaurant here in Staten Island. Are you coming? Yes, no, maybe. The no's you don't care about. The maybes you don't care about. The yeses you go over and you, if you can attend the event and they're the kinds of people who work in the kinds of companies doing the kinds of stuff you want to do, you say, hell yes, yes, I'm going. And so you say yes, and then you look at the people who said yes and you start to search for their accounts on LinkedIn and Facebook and get more information on them so that you can go into LinkedIn and send a request to join them and say, hey, we're both members of the ABC meetup group. I see you're going to the networking event in 2 weeks. Can't wait to meet up with you and talk about life after you graduated from Wagner and you're working at Google now. Or you're working at Meetup. I'd like to invite you to join me. I'd like to invite you to join my LinkedIn network. Boom. This is how you use this stuff. What's the second most popular search engine?
Yahoo?
No, hell no.
YouTube?
Yeah, because it's right in front of you. Who owns YouTube?
Google.
Thank you. You guys are the tech savvy ones. I'm the idiot. But if you've done any classes where you've been videotaped, if you've given any presentations, public speaking, for part of a class assignment, any way that you can get video of you, so that you can go to YouTube and create your first name, your last name, fill in the blanks, YouTube channel. Because in the old days, it was a resume. Now you can say, check out my YouTube channel. This is a way that you build your brand. Does anybody have a Tumblr account? One, two, I'm sorry, I didn't do this side of the room. Tumblr. Tumblr's really cool. Three, Tumblr is, sometimes it's used instead of a website. It is very much oriented to if your background, if you do photography or you have images, if you're a graphic designer or if you're a web developer, anything that lends itself to pictures, you can have a Tumblr account. I have a Tumblr account. I have no idea why I created it. Yeah, I do. Because I teach social media and I talk about social media, so I have to say, does anybody have a Tumblr account? I have one. But it's oriented mostly to people who are either in business, who make things that are visual, like cupcakes, or they're fashion designers. But you can also specify certain things you're interested in. On the top of the screen, when you create your account, it's free. One thing you can do is upload video. You can have chat with other people. You can insert links to websites that you find interesting or talks that you were involved with or your LinkedIn profile, updates to your Facebook page, or videos of you on your YouTube. oh, that didn't look good. It's a whole font issue. For you, I'm not autistic. That's not what that is. It's just the font didn't come through. Anybody have a Pinterest account? See, now I got, this is a 1, 2, 3, 4, a Pinterest. So it's interest with a P. Pinterest. It's free. So what the hell is it? It is a website, it's a social media tool where you create boards. Boards are, if you think about a board as an area of interest, let's say you're into modeling, or CAD-CAM, or trains, or transportation, or chemical engineering, whatever. Bad examples. You create boards. I have 18 that go 5, 5, 5, 3. Things that I, as a professional, want to tell everybody I'm interested in, or I'm doing, or I want to share. So my boards, I realize it's hard to read. Marketing, entrepreneurship, communications, leadership, managing your career. And then, of course, for those of you who are gluttons for punishment, my lifelong passion with the Cowboys, 17 years and counting. Motivational. It's a way to put what's called a pin. A pin is a relevant website. It's a video. Stuff that you've seen online that has to do with research you've done, class projects, you put a pin into each of the boards based on stuff that you're interested in or you're knowledgeable about. I know my time is kind of coming to a close and I'm way behind, but I wanted to say something about those bastards at Google. Hear me. Some of you are saying, what? Google? Sergey Brin, Larry Page, they're saints compared to Zuckerberg. Google started out as a company with one goal, one clear goal, to make the most elegant search. So they have now, depending on the research, between 7 and 9 billion searches a month, of which about 75 to 80% are Google. Google started out as a company that no matter where you were, no matter what your background, depending on what you put into that Google search, you would find the most specific results based on what you were looking for. Oh, plus the 5 or 6 dozen pieces of information they had about you, just in terms of the IP address on your device, based on your prior searching and other stuff you downloaded. So they customized your entire set of results every time you did a search. But now Google, about a year and a half ago, made a deal with the devil because they're competing with Facebook. Because Facebook was taking Google search away by people instead of going to Google to pose questions to their Facebook friends. Google has changed their search algorithms. It was called Author Note originally. Now it's changed. When people like HR professionals or recruiters are doing searches, Wagner College seniors, graduates, communications majors, and they're searching in Google, Google's algorithms are now completely tied into all the people you're connected to on Google circles. So what that means is Google's completely changed from what they started as a business and what their values were to say now it's all about maximizing your relationships and the things that other people who have relationships with you based on searching through Google circles. What the heck does this mean? How many people have a Google Circles account? Not enough. Every single one of you need to get a Google Circles account because that's how search is being maximized now through Google, which is a monopoly in the search business. This is a really cool tool. I don't know if any of you guys have heard of this. It's called Visify. It's basically a, how would you describe it? It's V-I-Z-I-F-Y. Visify.com, it's free. And what you do is you create your account and it'll say, give me your LinkedIn account, give me your Facebook account, give me your blog. Do you have a website? Do you have a Tumblr account? You put it all visually on a page and so you can tell people when you're meeting with them, and building your brand, yeah, you want all my social media accounts, go to visify.com/Ethan Chazen or whatever your name is, and you'll be able to put all of your online brands into one place. Have you guys ever heard of a software package called Prezi? It's a presentation. Cool. Prezi is the way you depict what used to be PowerPoint stuff in presentations on Prezi visually so that there's connections. That's what Visify is. This is just about.com. It's been a few years since Hootsuite came out. It's a free social media management service. What you do is you go to Hootsuite, H-O-O-T, Suite, S-U-I-T-I.com. You create an account. It'll say, that's great, you're here, thanks. What is your Facebook page, your LinkedIn page, your Twitter account? And so if you have two Facebook accounts, LinkedIn, Twitter, instead of going to all four of them every time you want to make an announcement about events you're going to, people you spoke to, you go to Hootsuite or Social Oom for one of these sites, and you put in the announcement or the comment once, and it'll say, that's great, where do you want to post this to? And it'll say, Facebook, check, LinkedIn, check. So instead of doing it in all your separate accounts, the three major ones, Twitter, LinkedIn, Facebook, you do it one and done. That's what it looks like. It's a dashboard. So you go and you create an account, and it'll say, hey, Facebook, this is what your feeds look like. Twitter, this is what your feeds. And you just click on the tab, and you can see your stuff. Go to Mashable.com to learn about all this stuff, the latest trends and developments, and sign up for the free e-newsletter. And I got to wrap this up probably soon. But this is what I want you to think about. People are searching for you right now. As you start to do your junior and senior job search tour, Call of Duty, where you're going out and meeting people, when you meet them, they may meet you for the first time and say, wow, pretty impressive. And they'll go back and say, I want to learn more about her later on. I want to learn more about you later on. Great meeting face to face. You need to monitor what's being said possibly about you, who's linking to you and doing all kinds of weird stuff. Once a month, if you're a senior, once every other month if you're a junior, I would say actually for everybody, once a month, go in, do your name, in quotation marks, do a search, Bing, Yahoo, Google, Bing, Yahoo, Google. Keep searching what's out there about you. If you're going to join or you're going to go after 3 to 4 industries that you want to work in when you graduate, they have user forums. Online forums where people who are in the industry are talking constantly about what it is to work in these industries. You want to join and monitor. You want to know what they say? I just recently was asked to do training at Calvin Klein. So, great. Went in, did training at Calvin Klein. How did I find out what people who work there or used to work there had to say about it? Glassdoor or Indeed. That's what you usually call an employee rant site. People who used to work at a place, Time Warner Cable, who hated it, they go online and bash it. So you want to also learn about what people are saying about organizations. It doesn't mean you're not going to go after them online and offline when you're talking, but you want to know what they're saying. These user forums are great. Ways to learn what people are talking about in the industries you're interested in. I probably want to wrap it up in the next 2 or 3 minutes to shut up and give you guys a chance to ask the real questions, since I may or may not have talked about a lot of what you wanted to hear. I'm aware of that. This is how you bring it all together. To go online, offline. So you join a meetup group, let's just say, or you come across somebody's name, or a dean or a professor gave you the name of somebody, and you're getting ready to meet her. First thing you do is you go check out all the social media tools, LinkedIn first, and then Facebook, and then go check them out on Twitter. Try to gather a little bit of information about them. What are their interests? What's their background? Where did they go to school? How long have they been working in their current job? Then you send them an invitation that's personalized, based on the research you did, to connect with you on LinkedIn. So that's the first thing you do, is send them an invitation. I use this guy Steve's example because he led this, doing this. You needed a reason to do this, $5,000. Just because I made the effort to reach out to somebody in advance of going out to a networking event, talking to him about some of the challenges he had, and then us forming a relationship in which he ultimately hired me, led to $5,000 worth of business. And that's how it started. I saw that he was going to an event, and I reached out to him by LinkedIn, sent an invitation. So you go, let's say you say, I'm going to attend an event, a meetup event. Then you promote it before the event by saying, hey, I'm going to this event through your social media accounts before you get there. You do it in all the major. Then you go to the event. I want to drop knowledge on you about a networking tool that I heard a few years ago, that I think is the best piece of advice I can give you. It's a number. 521. 521. And what that number stands for, each of those three numbers has significant meaning. The five is in the first 5 seconds that you meet somebody, can you say something that's so compelling that she says, wow, tell me more. And this is not an exact science either, but the numbers correlate to something that I'm trying to impress upon you. The two is when they say tell you more, you've got just a few minutes to follow that up with some additional information that supports that claim that you made that made her say wow. So that's the two in the 521. The one is at the end of your conversation at a networking event, it should basically be, that's really interesting. I'm glad we had the chance to talk and to meet you. I'd like to schedule some time after tonight or this afternoon to sit down with you and talk. So the one is an hour meeting. Quick question. You go to a networking event. The room is full of people. I don't care if it's 50 or 100 or whatever. How many people can you realistically talk to in an hour? If you're talking the whole time. You're not taking a break to go to the restroom or to get another beer. How many people can you talk to in an hour? Five? Not four. We're in the ballpark. Six. The way that comes out, that's pretty much five is, yeah. You should not be talking to anybody for more than 10 minutes at a networking event where you're going to meet as many people as possible, because the goal is, with that 521 rule in the back of your mind, at the end of 10 minutes, you should have follow-up of, this has been great, you want to close the conversation and say, I'll take ownership of following up with you after tonight to set up a time to meet. Because when you go to an event, you can't really talk more than 10 minutes, otherwise you're not going to meet enough people, assuming there's a lot of people in the room. So you go meet them at events, and then you go back online. After the event, what happened? I don't know what happened. After the event, you meet people, you go back to social media. If you didn't invite them to join you, you invite them to join you. You share relevant articles after the fact. You go back online, you have a conversation. You schedule times to meet with them. You meet with them in person. You go back online. You build relationships. That's what social media is about. I could talk to you for the next 3, 4, 5 hours. I know you're thinking, thank God you're not. Please don't. But there's a gazillion social media websites out there. You want four. LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, Meetup. Everything else, Tumblr, Pinterest, they're all gravy. My daughter's 12 years old. She knows technology like you would not believe. She's got an Instagram account. Apparently so do I. I'm really hot with the seventh grade community. But I don't know how she does it. She takes my whatever you call the night, the iPad, the small phone. What is that? The Apple phone. Thank you. And I turn around and say, what did you do? You moved all the apps around, the screens different. She goes, oh yeah, I just created an app and I did some coding and I completely customized. Whoa. Doesn't matter. There should only be four tools that you guys, in the interest of time, start using to build your brand. Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, Meetup. The other stuff is just gravy. The point of social media is it's not the only way to speak to people. It's a way to build an online presence and create relationships that reinforces all of the times you're meeting with people as you start your job search. If you have accounts, you want somebody to go back and do an audit of your social media accounts to make sure that your brand is okay, that your messaging is okay, and that you're emphasizing the right things. What does that mean in closing? All your social media accounts, your resume, your cover letter, it's the same thing as a marketer. The messaging should be, what are the three or four things that are most important that somebody should know about me professionally? What are the three or four things? If you've played sports competitively for all 4 years, that's significant. It shows dedication, teamwork, loyalty, commitment. If you serve on clubs, if you've done volunteer work, if you've been active in the Wagner College community, anything and everything that you want to emphasize three or four of your competencies, that's what needs to come across in your social media, as well as you talk about it when you meet people in person. So I'm going to stop now. I'm going to ask, what are you guys thinking about? What have you heard? What advice have people given?
I understand the importance of social media, especially with networking, but for me, I'm not necessarily a fan of having having all those forms of social media, because I feel like it takes away from your privacy in some sense, and I don't always like people knowing what I'm doing. I don't necessarily like to be accessible 24/7. You like to have some sort of privacy, and I feel like by having so many forms of social media, I mean, I understand it's important, LinkedIn, this is not including LinkedIn, so that's strictly for business reasons, but Facebook and Twitter and other sites like that, I feel like I'm not necessarily I'm not necessarily a huge fan of those because
okay.
I don't.
So then what I would say is amen, and I actually agree with you. I don't even want to have LinkedIn, but I have to. So you make sure that LinkedIn, if that's the one that you say I feel comfortable because I see the logic behind it and I can have conversations through LinkedIn, that be your social media tool of choice. So you direct everybody back to your LinkedIn. You don't have to have even all four of those. I would still say try Meetup just to get a sense of seeing by searching what groups are out there. But then if you don't feel comfortable with Twitter and Facebook, forget Twitter and Facebook. Just whatever tool works for you.
Well, I have a Facebook, so that's the one that and LinkedIn are playing on.
So then you're saying maybe Twitter.
Twitter is
just like, because, by the way, you say you don't want to have to be accessible 24/7, 365, I get it. You don't have to be accessible necessarily in Twitter or even Facebook if those are more personal, kind of checking in relationship-wise. But I will tell you, as you guys are getting ready to graduate, you do need to be accessible through the primary one, two, or three tools you use in terms of check in on a preset amount of time on a regular basis. So if you're going to say every day, then I would say 15 minutes. If you check in every other day for half an hour, cool. But have a schedule and do make yourself accessible on a regular basis, because this is not about jumping in, making announcements, saying bye. It's having conversations, it's listening to people online, sharing information. The tool that you use, if it's just LinkedIn, that's fine, but be fully engaged and jump in for a preset amount of time. If you're going to pick one tool to use, I would say LinkedIn is the way to go, honestly, if you're going to start up. Yeah. Was that kind of where you were going? I mean, I hate the fact that I'm out there the way I am, but I have to. I run a business. What else? What have people said to you that may sound confusing or just downright wrong? Yes, ma'am.
What do you recommend for privacy settings on all the social media?
The privacy settings, as a general rule, is set them at a maximum threshold so that you restrict the amount of people who have access to it, without getting into specifics, but just as much of the maximum settings as you can set and still allow the people that you're allowing to come in, have conversations with you and connect with you so that I don't have to be specific for each one, but
yeah.
The maximum amount, I'll say it yet, you know, another time differently, so that the people who are finding you and just not appropriate, you filter out, and the people who you want to have conversations filter in. I'm actually a really bad person to ask that question to because I have them pretty low, which is like not smart, but it's kind of, I try to cast a big net. I know I need to push mine up. Go as high as you can and still, for example, in LinkedIn, I'm at the point now where people are not allowed, there are certain people who I've gone back to LinkedIn and said, I don't know these people, they're sending me invitations to connect. And so now these are people who, every time they go in and try to connect to somebody on LinkedIn, they won't just let you send a message, you have to actually put their email address in. Because I've actually notified LinkedIn, there are people who are trying to connect to me, I don't feel comfortable with this, this is spam, I don't know them, you know, so I notify them. Yes, ma'am. What do you do?
I created a website and I helped produce a video, I have both of those on there. But my Tumblr is basically like music posts because I'm interning in the music industry.
Good luck with that.
I'm not necessarily just applying to music jobs.
Good.
I don't know if I
Good.
Should put that on
there or not. Tumblr. Possibly Pinterest, video, if you have it, create a YouTube channel of your work. As many ways, if you have images that you've created, visual stuff, websites, I would put those out there electronically. Yeah. Because it's, again, in my day, because I had a physical portfolio. I carried around a portfolio of all my work, and during interviews, I'd open it up, and I'd say, here, here, here. It's the visual equivalent. Or if you've got video that you've ever created, what you can do is create a QR code, a quick response code, and buy 500 business cards for $9 at Vistaprint and put a QR code on the back. And if somebody scans it, it goes to that 2 or 3 minute video about you on YouTube. I mean, there's a whole bunch of things you can do. But yeah, for you, visually, Pinterest and Tumblr. Yes, sir.
Here's a question I've been struggling with. I have just started an internship, and they really like me, and they said that depending on how the company goes, they'll probably hire me in a year. However, that's a lot of time for probably. How do I balance showing loyalty to this company so that this internship can become a job, but also searching for other jobs in the meantime?
Exactly what
you
just said. You don't have a contractual obligation or contractual commitment. It's a verbal, we may hire you in a year.
Right.
So you do your darndest to make sure that it does lead to a hire. But at the same time, you're not beholden to them where you can't go looking. As long as they know that you're out there and looking, that might actually push them more towards making a decision on your behalf and hopefully sooner than the year from now. So you're a junior?
I'm a senior.
Okay, so a year from now, a lot could happen in a year.
Right.
Unless you sign something, which there's no way you could ask a student to sign something saying don't look for other work.
Right.
It's amazing how attractive you become job-wise when you're working somewhere or you're about to work somewhere and you start getting offers or you start having interviews at other places. What I can tell you about your brand, be honest at all times. Be honest in how you present yourself on your social media. Be honest in every conversation you have. That's the best advice I can give you. You're not beholden to them. If they want, hire you. I had an offer at Sony that was taken back, which is right after I graduated from college in the music industry. Because they heard I was interviewing at what's VNU Media, where it used to be AC Nielsen, working at places like Billboard and Hollywood Reporter. They literally snatched an offer off the table. Yeah. What else are you guys thinking about? Well, look, I mean, you have the presentation. You can get access through it from Dr. Hempel. So I want to say thank you for having me tonight. Thank you so much. And if anybody has any questions, you should also feel comfortable to reach out to me if you want to talk directly.